As always, it's an awesome privilege and pleasure to be with you, to worship with you. And today we've got something that we're going to do very special towards the end of our teaching time, and that is we're going to participate in communion, celebrate communion together. So with that being said, at some point, if you would, could you please just go get some juice, some whatever you might have, milk, pop, water, it doesn't matter. It's and some bread. Again, these are just symbols that we use to celebrate the awesome relationship that we have with God through His Son, Jesus Christ. So we're going to be taking these at the end of the teaching time. So if you would, between now and then, don't skirt out or skate out on the worship time through singing. But if you would, just pause it or very quickly go grab a couple elements, and we're going to do communion towards the end of our time together. But before we get started, why don't I just open us up with a word of prayer? Would you bow your heads and your hearts with me as we just prepare ourselves to exalt Jesus? Father, we give you great thanks for this day. We give you great thanks for allowing us to be here, whether we're going to worship in person, whether we're going to watch this online, whether it's on Sunday morning, whether it's in the evening, afternoon. It really doesn't matter, because you told us throughout the scripture that we worship you in spirit and truth. And so today we come collectively together to do just that. And I pray that all that we do and say today would bring you glory, and that we would exalt you. And we pray all this in the most powerful name of your Son, our Lord, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children.
Well, we're in this series called Comfortable Lies, and we've been in it for the past 2 weeks. Hopefully you haven't checked out. As I've kind of been joking with some people, some of the things we've been talking about kind of makes us set our teeth on edge, you know? Where we talk about, you know, God wants me to be happy at all times. Or, you know, just some of the different things we've been looking at and how it kind of can rub us, you know? Because, you know, last week we talked about God... the comfortable lie that says God won't give us more than we can bear. And even though some of that is true, that's not what that passage of Scripture says in 1 Corinthians. Paul says that God won't allow any temptation to overcome us, that He will give us a way out, that He will give us an opportunity to get out from underneath of it. And so we've been looking at these things that a lot of times God just did not say that. Jesus did not say those things, but in order to make our lives a little bit more comfortable or a little bit more palpable, we will say some things like that. We will construct some comfortable lies. And today we're going to look at another one. And this is one that really goes against the philosophy of the world in which we live today. We hear this a lot. We engage in this a lot. We may have had some conversations. Some of us really may buy into this one. And again, I hope and pray that you just lean into this and you don't check out on me, that you stay and you listen to the whole thing, because the worst thing that can happen is you check out and then you formulate a thought that, or make an assumption that was not really communicated. So please hang in there with me and track with me. Today we're going to look at a comfortable lie that says this: humans are naturally good. We're all naturally good. That's how we are. In our natural state, humanity is good. Now, you and I both know a lot of people that are just good people. Some people we know that are, they're not even Christians, they're not Christ followers, but they're good people. In fact, we could even say this: some of us know people that are not Christians that tend to act more holy, if we could say it that way. That they're more good than even some of the Christians. We know some Christians that gossip. We know some Christians that will just verbally assault you and have all kinds of different things, you know, going on. And yet we look at someone that's not a Christian and they don't have those things. They're much more pleasant to be around. They're much more kind. They're much more kinder. They're you name it. And we look at it and we're like, wow, this is really odd. And so when we say humans in our natural state are good, and we're saying that's a comfortable lie, some of us can say, I don't know about that one. Good, because I want you to track with me, okay? I want you to spend some time with me here in the Word. Because what this state, when that statement is made, you know, just accept me for who I am. And that doesn't mean that we're here to not accept someone by any means or reject anybody. That's not the point of this. The point of it, though, is that some of us will say, well, you just accept me for who I am, because I'm good. Everything's okay. That's what that implies. It implies that our natural state is fine, that there's nothing that needs changed. And for some, it's like, why do I need to follow God? Why do I need to have a relationship with God? Everything's fine. I'm okay. Accept me for the way I am. Well, we can look at that and we can say, well, some of us make it even formulate somewhat of a dialogue or an argument to say, yeah, again, as we compare and contrast a Christian to a non-Christian. But I want you to listen to a passage of Scripture found in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 3, in which Paul says this: for the time will come when they will not tolerate sound doctrine, but according to their desires will multiply teachers for themselves, because they have an itch to hear something new. Paul's saying there's going to be a time coming when people are not going to entertain the truth. They're not going to entertain doctrine. They're not going to entertain the truths in which we say are found in this book, the Bible. Okay? They are not going to tolerate that. They're going to say, you know what? I don't need that. I'm fine. I'm okay. I don't need something differently, or I don't need something different, that I'm okay. And what can happen is, or what Paul is saying, there's a time coming, and I think you and I both know it, that we live in that time right now and have been living in that time. But there's a time coming when people will not tolerate sound doctrine. They will not tolerate, they will say, well, the Bible was written so many years ago to a certain group of people, which is true, I get that. But they will say that there's not timeless principles. There's not timeless truths. There's not truths that expand over over time, okay? And they're not going to tolerate that, but according to their desires, what they want to do, their human desires, their human propensities, their human compulsions, what they want to do then, they will multiply teachers that will align with that and will actually teach that and say, you know what, that's okay. It's okay. You just be you. God loves you for just who you are, okay? And this is where it gets kind of scary, okay? Because think about this. Someone, and we'll just use this one, someone verbally assaults you, okay? Someone verbally assaults you, or let's just say that's who they are. They get upset, they get angry, and they just verbally assault you every single time. We're just going to use this as an example, an illustration. They verbally assault you every time. And then someone comes along and says this: you just got to accept them for who they are. That's just the way they are. And then they will even make this statement: they have a good heart. No. Something is off. Something's not lining up here. They have heart issues. Something's going on with the heart, okay? And the Bible talks about this. And the first thing I'm going to share with you is what the Bible has to say about the natural heart, which means the heart that we have that we're born into. The heart is that place where, if we could say, it's not just, you know, a physical organ within our body, a scientific organ to look at and to study, to hold and to see how it gives life, which that's exactly what it does to us, right? But the Bible looks at the heart as something where our emotions resides, our desires resides, all of those things. And the Bible indicates that sin has disrupted that, that sin has created within us a bad heart, okay? That in fact, that everything's not okay, that we have heart issues. Jeremiah 17:9, listen to what God says to the prophet. The heart is more deceitful than anything else and incurable. Who can understand it? Did you hear that? That's what the Bible, that's what the Word of God has to say about the heart, the natural heart of man, as we're born into this world, that it's bad, that sin has corrupted it, that it's incurable, that it's deceitful. And how can anyone understand it? Those are powerful words. And now you're going to tell me that we just need to follow our hearts? Well, we need to be very clear and make sure that our hearts are in a good spot, in a good position, and that we've had, you know, a heart regeneration, because if not, the Word of God saying the heart is more deceitful than anything else and incurable, and who can understand it? Did you hear those words? Number one, it says it's dishonest or it's deceitful, okay? Now, I love that word deceitful, if I could say it that way, because it doesn't say dishonest. There's a difference between dishonest and deceitful, okay? Think about it. Dishonest, someone may just be dishonest. They may just flat out lie, okay? You know them. That's who they are. You know their heart, right? That's who they are. They're just dishonest. You don't trust them because you just know that that's just who they are. They're dishonest, okay? But then you have someone who's deceitful. Now, deceitful, I think, is a little bit different. Deceitful implies, or deceitful indicates, that the person might take truth and intertwine it into lies to make a lie look like a truth. That's what Satan, that's who he is. He's very deceitful. He's not just dishonest. He's very deceitful. He takes something, the truth, and he turns it and makes it counterfeit. Takes something that is true, takes something that looks very true, and twists it just enough to mislead you. That's, to me, so much worse, right, than just being dishonest. Someone who is deceitful. Dishonesty just flat out lies. Deceitfulness takes truth and intertwines it into lies. The Bible says that your heart is incurable. In the natural state that we're born in, our hearts are incurable. Man, that's depressing. That sounds so discouraging. Our hearts are so incurable. And who can understand it? You know, when David fell to his sin, and he was just, under conviction. He was just, you know, he talks about, you know, in Psalm 51, how he was just so mournful and remorse and all these other things. He prays a prayer and he says this, create in me what? A clean heart, a new heart, a heart that's not dishonest any longer, a heart that's not deceitful, a heart that's not incurable, a heart that could be understood. You see, the problem is, here's the problem. We were created, okay? From the very beginning, we were created to mirror God's heart. That's what Adam and Eve was, you know, basically put in the garden to mirror who God is, to showcase God's glory, to mirror God's heart. We were created to love Him. We were created to serve Him. We were created to commune with Him. Think back in the garden, you know, when God came down and would spend time with Adam and Eve, and it says in the cool of the evening, and He would fellowship with them. That's what He desired more than anything else, is to fellowship with His prized creation, His most loved creation. And He wanted to receive that love back, and for them to serve Him, for them to commune with Him, for them to glorify Him. That's what we were created for. You see, God's desire is for us to literally respond to His love, okay? But the problem is we can't. The problem is it goes back to our hearts. And when we are born into sin, as the Bible teaches, when we're born into sin, we have this natural heart, we have this heart that's fallen, we have this heart that's broken. We do not have the propensity or the inclination or the desire to serve God, to glorify Him, to commune with Him. That's not in our natural state. And for someone to say, well, everything's okay, everything's all right, just follow your heart, you better be very careful, because you need to understand, or to know, truly know, where your heart is. And so that's the problem. But God, out of his incredible love of who he is, not just that's what he does, but that's the essence of who he is. That's his character. That's him. He is love. He doesn't leave us in that state, right? He sees that we have this incurable, deceitful heart that can't be understood. And instead of leaving us in that situation, God says, I'm going to give you a new heart. And we read about even this about clear back in the Old Testament. Israel, his people, his creation, his people, his nation that he created that was going to represent him, glorify him, serve him, all these things, they kept falling into sin. They kept falling into idolatry. They kept worshiping other false gods. They had this broken heart that needed fixed, and they couldn't fix it. The law couldn't fix it. The Ten Commandments couldn't fix it. The kings couldn't fix it. The prophets couldn't fix it. It needed to be fixed. But again, it goes back to it's incurable, right? And it had to be fixed. And there's only one person that could fix that, and that would be God, right? God is the one. In Ezekiel chapter 18:31, listen to what he says. He says, throw off all the transgressions you've committed and get yourselves a new heart. You need a new heart. This, what you're doing is wrong. This way is the furthest from the truth. It's against who I am. You need to throw all those things off. And he's speaking through the prophet Ezekiel, and he's telling them, you're falling into sin. You need to turn from your ways. Throw off all the transgressions you've committed and get yourselves a new heart and a new spirit. Why should you die, house of Israel? That's what God says. God's saying you need a new heart, you need a new spirit, because what you have is not taking you in the right direction. You keep following. In the days of the judges, if you remember reading through that particular book back in the Old Testament, the day of the judges, they kept getting into this vicious, sinful cycle. And that's what it was. It kept saying they kept doing what they thought was right in their own eyes. It's exactly what we do now. If our hearts have not been regenerated, if we do not have a new heart, if we still have an old heart, we are going to go towards sin every single time. And so again, for us to say, just follow your heart. Everything's okay. Guys, it's not okay. It's not okay. Because we don't have the ability to do what is right, to do what is good per se. And God is saying this, throw it off. Throw off all the transgressions you've committed. Walk away from them. Get yourselves a new heart and a new spirit. Well, he's basically kind of setting a message up here to say that you can't do it, but only I can do it for you. And that's where the love of God absolutely comes in. So in Ezekiel 18:31, that's what he says. Ezekiel 36:26, listen to what he says. And this is exactly what I was just trying to share with you. He says this, I will give you a new heart, and I will put a new spirit within you. Did you get that? I will. God's saying that. You can't. You can't do this. But I can. I will give you a new heart, and I will put a new spirit within you. I will remove your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. That's what he says. He says, you know what? I will take care of it. I will do it. I get that your heart is broken. I get that your heart is incurable. It's deceitful. Who can even understand it? But you need to walk away from your transgressions. You need a new heart. You need a new spirit. You can't do it. But I can, and this is what I am going to do. And that is the awesome news of God. God says, I'll give you a new heart. You can't do anything about it, but I will. And essentially what's going to happen, you're going to go from a sin-focused life to a God-focused life. You're going to go from pleasuring yourself. You're going to go from everything being hedonistic about bringing yourself pleasure to, what does God want for my life? I want to bring God glory. This isn't about me. My life, the world doesn't revolve around me. I'm going to focus my life. I want my life to be focused on God. And that's what happens when we have a new heart and a new spirit. Now, we're not perfect. We're not perfect. But in God's eyes, we are. As God looks at us and we'll get to this, through the blood of Christ, His Son, the crucifixion, the sacrifice, the great exchange, God gives us His Son's righteousness that's absolutely pure, that's absolutely perfect. He gives that to us and exchanges our sin and crud and all that for His righteousness, which from that perspective, yes, we do look perfect through the blood of Christ because Christ was perfect. That's what makes it such a great exchange. But here's the deal. there's going to be times where we're going to slip. 1 John 1:8 tells us that. If we say that we're never going to have sin in our lives, that we've never, you know, messed up as a human, we're lying to ourselves, and God's not in us. The Spirit of God's not in us. His love's not in us. It can't be. It can't be, because now we're back to saying that I can do this, that I can take care of this, and that is false across the board. But God gives us this new heart. God gives us this new heart, this new spirit, as He says through the prophet of Ezekiel. If you would, would you turn to 1 Samuel with me real quick? And I want to share with you a really, just a really cool story, a very quick story of what took place when Saul was first anointed king. So in 1 Samuel chapter 10, Samuel, being God's prophet, comes and he's going to anoint Saul as being the first king. This is who God picked, okay? Listen to what it says. Samuel took the flask of oil, poured it out on Saul's head, kissed him, and said, "Hasn't the Lord anointed you over his inheritance?" Okay? He asked him that question. Hasn't the Lord anointed you ruler over his inheritance? Now, if you would, drop down to verse 9, and I just want you to take a look at this. Actually, drop down verse 5. It says, after that you will come to, and it talks about these events that's going to happen with these other prophets and things. And it says in verse 5, after that you will come to Gibeah of God, where there are Philistine garrisons. When you arrive at the city, you will meet a group of prophets coming down from the high place prophesying. They will be preceded by harps, tambourines, flutes, and lyres. The Spirit of the Lord will come powerfully on you. You will prophesy with them, and you will be what? Transformed. You see, that's what happens when the Spirit of God comes upon us. That when we respond to His love, when we invite Him in as He's pursuing us, and we respond to His free gift of grace and salvation, we become powerfully changed. We become powerfully transformed. It goes on to say this in verse 9, when Saul turned around to leave Samuel, God changed his heart. And all the signs came about that day. When Saul and his servant arrived at Gibeah, a group of prophets met him. Then the Spirit of God, listen to this, then the Spirit of God came powerfully on him, and he prophesied along with them. And in verse 11, I think it's very interesting. Everyone who knew him, what? Previously, before God did this, everyone who knew him previously and saw him prophesy with the prophets asked each other, what has happened to the son of Kish? What has happened to this guy? He's different. You see, that's what happens when God powerfully transforms us. That's what happens when God gives us this new heart, this new spirit that he plants inside of us. God powerfully transforms us. We become a new person, a new creation, as Paul writes in the New Testament. We become selfless and become more God-filled. This new heart, with no new heart, there's no obedience. There's no repentance. There's no love for God. There's no desire to please Him. But with this new heart, these things come with that. We're able to be obedient, which is what God requests. In fact, that's what takes us to the next and last point that I want to share with you, is the result of a new heart, this change that takes place. All right? Ezekiel 11, 19 through 20 says this, and I will give them one heart. Again, he's talking through the prophet Ezekiel. I will give them one heart and put a new spirit within them. I will remove their heart of stone from their bodies and give them a heart of flesh. So what? So they may follow all of my statutes, keep my ordinances, and practice them. Then they will be my people, and I will be their God. Do you see what happens in our natural state with our old heart? That can't happen. We're not going to be obedient. That's what the Word of God teaches us, that we do not have the ability to, we're not okay. We don't have the ability to please God or to love Him, to exalt Him, to do what, or to be, I should say, what God desires, to glorify Him, to mirror Him, to love Him, to serve Him, to commune with Him. But with a new heart that He gives us, freely, just by responding to His free gift of grace and love, He puts a new heart and a new spirit within us so that we can do what? So that we can keep His ordinances, so that we can live live a life that's pleasing to Him, that's holy. Remember, First Peter tells us that we're changed. We're no longer this person over here, but we're different. Okay, God, now we're able to keep His ordinances and to be holy and to practice them. And He says, I think beautiful ending of this verse. Then they will be my people and I will be their God. That's what happens when we have a new heart. The result of a new heart is that it's all about God. It's not about our doing, but His. It's not about our good works, but His. It's not about our righteousness, but His righteousness. It's all about Him. It's all about what He does and what we can't do. Did you hear that? What we can't do in our natural state. Oh, that rubs us, doesn't it? As humans, don't tell me what I can't do. Don't tell me how I'm wrong. Don't tell me that my heart's not right. And, you know, I'll show you. For what? It's a futile purpose. And why are you trying to show me? The Word of God teaches something differently. I want to close, and then we're going to take communion with John chapter 3, verses 1 through 8. That famous dialogue that he has with a Pharisee, Nicodemus. And if you remember, Nicodemus was a Pharisee, a teacher, and he comes to Jesus at night and he basically says, man, we know that you've got to be of God because of the things that you're doing. No one else can do the things that you're doing. And I'm paraphrasing here, but I'd like for you to spend time reading this particular passage because it's key. It's Jesus is teaching this whole concept of having a new heart to Nicodemus. And he's saying, Nicodemus, this isn't about you. And I think Nicodemus is coming with a question that says, man, we're trying to keep the law. We're trying to do all these things, but it's absolutely impossible. So your way sounds very different. And he begins to question Jesus, okay? And Jesus basically tells him this, you got to be born again. You've got to be born again. Nicodemus in his natural state can't understand that. It doesn't make sense to him, okay? How can I enter into my mom's womb again? How can I be born physically again? I'm an old man. This can't happen. Which Jesus says, you're right. That way can't happen, and that's not what I'm talking about. But Jesus talks about, you know, born again and how that He's the one that does it, right? That there's this rebirth. And when we have this rebirth, when we have this new heart placed within us, when we have this new spirit placed within us, and the old gone, the old heart and the old spirit gone, then we have this new heart. It's like a do-over. Again, we keep coming back to that great exchange. I'm going to give God this junk, and He's going to give me a second chance. He's going to give me a do-over, which, oh, by the way, doesn't He give us a lot of do-overs? I don't know if you like to play golf. I like to play golf, but the one thing I love about golf, and it's not even part of the game per se, is a little thing called a mulligan. And that's when you hit a ball and it goes completely in the opposite direction you want it to go in, and you can call for a mulligan and you can get another shot. And you can put the ball down right there and hit it again. Again, it's not the way you really play golf, but man, it makes it so much more fun, right? Because it gives you a second chance and a third chance and a fourth chance. And it doesn't really represent things well, but, and that's kind of a poor illustration, but my point is this. God's saying, you don't have to live in the state you're in. You don't have to live separated from me. You don't have to live in a position where you're going to be damned to hell for eternity. You're going to spend eternity in a Christless place, with just absolutely no hope, no nothing, absolutely nothing to look forward to. But instead, I love you, and I will give you this new heart. I will give you this rebirth. I will give you this new spirit, this new heart. I will exchange it for you. Isn't that incredible news? And that's what we're going to celebrate today. Guys, if you've never responded, and I mean truly responded, I'm not talking cognitively, I'm not talking about you just thinking, I'm talking about a heart where your heart has been truly exchanged, where you've offered up your heart to Jesus, where you've responded to God's love, and you've accepted this free gift, this new heart that he's willing to place in you, and this new spirit within you, this rebirth, this regeneration to where now you will be His people. And He will be your God. If you haven't done that, now's the time. God's pursuing you. I know that. I'm convinced of that. Why? Because you're listening to this right now. And why would you be listening to this? Because God's pursuing you and God's moving you. I would pray that you would respond to Him now just by simply saying, God, I accept your free gift of salvation. My life is yours. My life is yours. And it's all about you. And it's not about me. And just respond to Him. And that right there is the perfect position and posture to put you in to celebrate what God has done in your life. And those of you that have already done that and that are walking with God and you're one of His children and you're celebrating right now, we're going to take communion and we're going to celebrate that. So if you would, get your juice and your bread and let's celebrate the incredible rebirth, the regeneration through the blood and the flesh, this great sacrifice, the great exchange of Jesus. So if you would, let's take the bread and let's eat it. And it symbolizes the body, the flesh of Jesus as He hung on the cross, this great that sacrifice. Let's take and let's eat. And now let's take the juice that represents His blood that was shed for your sins and for my sins to be able to give us a new heart. For Him to be able to give us His righteousness, His purity, in exchange for our junk, our sinfulness. Let's take and let's celebrate. Father, we give You great thanks for who You are. We give You great thanks for Your love. May we receive, may we live with this new heart in us and this new spirit within us. May we be people that live in Your ordinances, giving You glory, communing with You, serving You, all of those things. May we be truly Your children. And we give You thanks, and we give You praise, and we exalt You in the most powerful name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen and amen. It was great worshiping with you. Look forward to worshiping with you next week as we explore another comfortable life. Have a great week.